So, I designed this talk to fit into 30 minutes, so please interrupt me with any questions you might have. So, most of you will have heard this phrase, homotopy type theory should be for the language of elementary infinity one properly, but I mean, whatever that may mean, for sure it means that only groupoids should form a model of homotopy type theory. So I will start by writing this still very imprecise thing actually down. Because to make this precise, of course, you first have to choose a specific presentation of omega groupoids, which by itself is a very ill-defined concept. And the most common instantiation is using Hahn complexes in the simplicial sets. So that's quite an old setting. I will write this for pre-sheaves over a category, and this, of course, is the simplex category. And I assume everyone is familiar with simplices. So, simplicial sets endowed with the Kahn order structure present omega groupoids, which you can also view as homotopy types of spaces. I hope everybody can read my writing. And then we can make this precise, and this is exactly what Vladimir Kolbotsky has done at the, many years ago actually nowadays. So that was the first model of homotopy type theory. Kolbotsky's, and I suppose written up and detailed by Kapulkin and Lumsden. Simplicial set model of homotopy type theory. And that's all fine and good, but for people interested in constructive logic, there's a problem here because both of these facts kind of use classical logic all around. So these two things are very, very classical. So the question is, can we interpret this somehow also in a purely constructive way? So let me just put some constructively here with a question mark. And that's related to a more recent development in homotopy type theory. There are now these so-called cubical models of homotopy type theory, and in contrast to the simplicial model, they are developed using purely constructive methods and have been shown to form a model of homotopy type theory. So we should consider these recently constructive cubical models of homotopy type theory, and I will say later in detail which of these I consider. And then, of course, we have the evident questions. First of all, can these models also be seen as presenting omega groupoids? Or there are several variations in these models, and is there a variation of one of the models that can be seen as presenting omega groupoids? Let me just write this as, do these present omega groupoids? And then, of course, you can also ask independently of type theory, is there some constructive model of omega groupoids? And of course, we want to be able to do some work in these models, and the least things that I want to be able to do, let's say I want to be able to do all the things I can do in a model category, so the question then becomes, is there a constructive model category for omega groupoids? And if either of you know the answer to any of these questions, please interrupt me. That's what I meant, for example. I said you could interrupt me. is there a constructive model category presenting omega groupoids?
I'll interrupt you with a question. By presenting omega groupoids here, you mean presenting homotopy types of spaces?
Yeah. So, for convenience, let's say.
So then the question, can this question be formulated in a constructive setting?
So the test for whether something is a correct notion of omega groupoids, for this I would use classical logic and examine then whether classically this constructive notion becomes equivalent to the classical notion once you allow yourself to use classical logic.
So for follow-up question, do we want to use topological spaces or locales? There's, for instance, a paper by Eric Pomper that shows that some things at least work better in locales than in spaces.
I don't have any ideas about locales. Please talk to me after the talk. Right, so this will be the theme for this talk, and I'm amazed how much time I've already wasted, so let's go on. If this was a slide, it would have been just 30 seconds, but no, 7 minutes.
You still have some time to think about it.
Yeah. Okay, thank you for the interruption. So, I want to talk about cubical models, and before I can do this, I should make precise what I mean by that, and in particular, cubical implies something to do with cubes, so I'll start with the cube categories, which are the starting point. And since I'm also the first person to talk more about these cubical models, there are later in the workshop more talks about this, several talks in fact, I think it's my duty to give maybe an elementary introduction at first, and you guys can do stuff with less time wasted. Okay, so... cube categories. And the most convenient way to describe them, in my opinion, is to just give them as free constructions, because that works generically for all the cases that we currently have. So, let's say we define a cube category, and there will be various cube categories, so this definition will be kind of open. Is free, of course. And then our first choice is with respect to the monoidal structure of the cube category. The least powerful, the least rich cube categories just have some monoidal product. We can bunch dimensions together, but the order in which we bunch dimensions together matters. We cannot really exchange them. So we could either have a free monoidal structure, we could have a symmetric monoidal structure allowing us to freely swap dimensions, or we could even have a Cartesian monoidal structure which would allow us to duplicate dimensions, to have diagonals. And one peculiarity of these cube categories is always that the unit of the monoidal structure is always terminal, even if we are not in this case. And then we have certain further operations. So we always have something called endpoint inclusions. So usually I write these as just 0 or 1. So I'm going from the unit to, I forgot an object I have. On an object I. So we have endpoints. Sometimes it's confusing that I write 0, 1 even though I also use 1 for the terminal object. I also sometimes use delta 0 or delta 1 in that setting. This is always present, and then we have some optional stuff. For example, something called connections. And the current fashionable notation for these is using disjunction and conjunction symbols. So this goes from I tensor I to I. So only in the Cartesian case is there really a product. I will be generic, and most often might just the tensor, and it's tensor times, not tensor plus. And these satisfy some laws that you might expect from just seeing them as sort of a minimum or maximum operation on a topological interval. So for example, if I plug in the zero endpoint into the left argument of this disjunction thing, it does nothing. Or if I plug in the one endpoint, the result will always be one, no matter what. So I just write plus laws because I don't want to spend time here. We can go on and actually give more structure. Something that has been considered in a cubical model are reversals, which some people confusingly call symmetries. I hope there are none of these people present in the room. So that's an endomorphism in I that satisfies the expected behavior. So it sends 0 to 1 and 1 to 0 and sends these two operations to each other and so on. But it turns out there are actually more laws you can add. So if you only add the laws that I just mentioned, you will get so-called De Morgan cubical sets. But you can also add further laws. For example, you could have so-called Kleene cubical sets, where you add a certain law of the form, let me use algebraic theory notation. Of course, you can also always use an algebraic theory to talk about the Cartesian model case. And then such a law would look like a and not x, and not x is always less or equal than x, than y or not y, where you can define this as just e and a is a, I guess. And you can also have something of the form x or not x is 1, then you get something called Boolean cubical sets. This was clean, and these have all been considered. And I guess you could do more stuff. People have considered subdivision structures on the interval and so on, but for the purpose of this talk, which has been going on for already 50 minutes, let's stick to these things. Okay? So, of course, you can also describe this using, I don't know, in the monoidal case, as a category of operators of a certain operator, or symmetric operator in the symmetric model case, or as a finite product theory in the Cartesian monoidal case, or I don't know, as the opposite of a Kleist category for certain monoid and finite sets, for example, the De Morgan cubical sets, where I here normally mean the Cartesian monoid structure will just be the opposite of the Kleist category of the free De Morgan algebra, monoid and finite sets, and so on for these things. If you like more concrete descriptions of cube categories, then the more simple cube categories that don't have this rich structure, they can also be seen just as subcategories of cosets. So let me just briefly remark this because I will end up talking about this at the end of it. So simple cube categories, and this is my way of generically speaking about a cube category because it's just two symbols. Also arise as subcategories of cosets on objects that are just of the form this coset to the power of n, where n is just an extra number, and this, of course, is just the coset where you have two objects related in this way. For example, for, I don't know, endpoint inclusion, you could then go on and represent the endpoint inclusion as explicit generators of, described using certain generators. Okay. And the last remark that I want to make just about cube categories before I go to the pre-sheaf setting is that even though the very early cube categories, those that have been considered for a very long time already, they are very nice and simple and admit something people call a greedy or even a, well, I shouldn't say even more, at least a generalized greedy structure, which helps you to analyze the content of homotopy theories, modeled pre-sheaves over these. The richer ones, they do not. So for those that know about greedy structures, you should take into account that if you have connections, symmetries, and diagonals, so in the Cartesian case, then all loops of a generalized greedy structure are lost. So with Cartesian connection, no hope of greedy structure, or even a generalized greedy structure. And the very easy counterexample is just by looking at this map given by, in the first argument, x and y, and in the second argument by x or y, and to observe that this is not invertible. Clearly, the result cannot distinguish x and y from each other, but also that it does not factor via a one-dimensional cube. This is one of the things you would definitely need to have for generalized 3D structure.
Can you put the board up becomes small?
Say again?
Put the board up becomes
small. When you want to have the needle, they will be able to stand.
Yeah, but now you can't see the top half. You don't care about it. I know. not invertible, does not factor via a less dimensional cube, let's say just a one dimensional cube. And finally, we need a notation, a scheme for denoting these various things because we have various different models. And our notation will be inspired by first this case distinction. So we either drop our piece of chalk, we either take the monoidal case, the symmetric monoidal case, or the Cartesian monoidal case, and then we add all the further operations that we want to have. So we might have, for example, connections, we might also have reversals, and for reversals we would then also have to indicate which loss we want, and then we just write, I don't know, De Morgan, Kleene, or Gould, or whatever. So that will be my notation for cube categories. One last remark, many of these models, they actually work for more general categories than these. In particular, you could just forget about the three here and take any arbitrary category that satisfies these conditions, more or less. And for some of the models, you will still be able to interpret it in pre-sheaf for this category. And this then also gives you examples such as symmetric simplicial sets, which you can verify has all these operations and is a Cartesian monoidal category, or even richer categories, subcategories of both sets. 30 enough about that.
So in this example, so there is no really structure, but can you adapt really models? So can you find
adapt really models?
Well, the really structure will produce model categories.
If we have a reading model structure, yeah.
That's the point. So
but
not a reading structure, can you?
Not all reading model structures give you a model of homotopy type theory. Maybe I misunderstood your question. Okay. So now let's switch to cubical models. These will be in pre-sheaves over one of these categories. And what these models have in common is that types are modeled as certain vibrations, but as structured vibrations. And that's one part of what makes the model constructive. that being a type is not just a property, you endow types with a certain kind of lifting operation. So I will not go into detail yet, so I'll just say theme types modeled as structured vibrations. In some kind of pre-sheaf category over a cube category, and this typically means that it's like the category of algebras for an algebraic refactorization system. Or variations thereof, because there are now actually various different ways of talking about vibrations using filling, composition, coercion, and all this new stuff. Okay, so now actually I need a new board, but I already wasted this one. So let me just draw some vague cloud, because now there's like this magic ingredient that some people have apparently, and others like me don't. I would call it black magic. So after a while, there will come out some cubical models of type theory. And sorry if you don't like this analogy. It's the best I can do, because I didn't come up with these models. For me, it's black magic. And the first one was the so-called VCH model, named after the authors of the VCH paper. And that was not the joke, that was the joke, but okay. So, can we continue? Okay, so this is...
I only laugh a lot at the joke, is it?
It's Mark Bays on Thierry Foucault and Simon Huber.
Yeah, I knew that. So this is on a pre-sheaf over symmetric cubes with no connections. So just endpoints, symmetries, not much else going on. So it's so simple that in fact it still is a generalized 3D category. And the vibrations I won't go into detail because I won't talk so much about this model. They find by requiring a lifting structure against certain generating to be co-vibrations, which you can say are of the form delta k, and then I write push-out tensor, and this is the normal push-out product construction for this tensor product, where the tensor product on the pre-sheaf category is of course induced from the tensor product of the index category by co-continuous extension, k convolution. And here we have, let's say, some cube boundary inclusion. So that's like a j-dimensional cube, where j is a finite set. This is the boundary, which I won't formally define. And then we have maybe some other cubical set A. So j finite set, A another cubical set. And then they have a further uniformity condition that if you exchange elements of J, that the chosen lifts are actually coherent. So let me just say coherent in permutations of J. But I actually think, at least that's what I thought when I first checked this model, that this coherence here is actually not necessary. I mean, there was some further condition, some further coherence in the other part, which I guess assumed into just tensoring with an arbitrary cubical set. That one really mattered, but here I think it should also work to just say boundary inclusion of an n-dimensional cube and no further coherence of lifts against this. I didn't really check. So that's the first one. And then sometime later, there came the CCHM model. And the list of capital letters just increases from here. And this was on Cartesian two-bitlet sets with connection operations and reversals that satisfy the De Morgan laws. And I mean, I guess I can just write De Morgan because that implies connections. But a key difference of this model over this one is that this one is more generic. It can actually adapt it to pre-shift categories over index categories that are at least as rich as this one. So one of the first things that you observe in reading this paper, I think they actually say already in the paper, is that the reversals, they don't actually matter for the model. So let's say actually on Cartesian with connections. And if you look very carefully and you don't care about highlighted tiles, you can also get rid of diagonals and just have symmetries and connections without hits. But crucially, what I already said, or settings of the same, of at least that region. Let's say of at least that level of richness. Okay. And another difference to this model is that here actually we have one more ingredient, a choice of so-called cofibrations. Or let's say a certain choice, because of course there's always a constraint. And I write C for cofibrations from now on. And the maximal one is just component-wise decidable monos. And right about now we should reach the point where you have trouble reading my writing. You know if that is correct. And then we can describe the fibrations using just a normal lifting property, because all this uniform lifting structure business, you can always express the property of having such a structure as just a single universal lift. So you can alternatively just say vibrations are those snaps that lift against. First you take one of the endpoint inclusions, and then you push out tensor it with co-fibration. So I just write this, and I promise to explain this push-out product construction. I will just do it by example in this case. So in this example, let's say we take the zero endpoint inclusion, and let's say our co-fibration is denoted M from A to B, then the push-out tensor would be the map that in the codomain is just computed as the normal tensor. And here, we kind of either take the domain here and the codomain here, or the other way around, and then take the evident pushout. So in this case, 0, which is just a stand-in for the terminal object, tensor B, co-product over 0 times tensor A, by tensor A. So that's this thing here.
Maybe they are called open boxes.
They are called open boxes, indeed, yes. And the shape that people usually draw is like this.
Yeah.
Yeah. It's like a secret symbol of... Yeah. Okay. I don't want this to become too conspiracy themed. Okay, where's my cloud? Okay, so now we have two things, but actually very, very recently, and that's the newest development, there's like another sprout coming from the cloud, and that's the, I like to call it the ABC-HHL thing.
Epic.
Yeah, I mean, depends on, yeah. Depends on the bibliographical conventions that you use.
Use that.
You want to use F, okay.
F says T is F.
Okay. And so people have actually figured out that the use of connections here, which I at least for a long time thought would be very crucial and necessary, is not needed. You can build the model completely without connections, But you have to pay a price, actually two different prices. But well, let's come to this now. The first one, so first it's a model based on Cartesian cubes, so no longer connections, and the same remarks I did here apply, so you can build a model in any setting that is at least as rich as this, doesn't have to be exactly this, but needs to be some Cartesian thing with some, yeah, I mean the conditions I won't write down formally here, I mean maybe people will use this in later talks. So again, some choice of group vibrations, but they are more constrained, and that now the diagonal inclusion which we get from the Cartesian structure has to be a co-fibration. So essentially, this must belong to C. And the second change is that this notion of vibration is no longer enough. We need to strengthen what it means to be fiber and to be a vibration. And the way I've heard people explain it to me was that instead of composing from 0 to 1, you compose from an interval variable to another interval variable, but I don't know if that makes any sense to you. I went ahead and I googled Cartesian cubic sets on Google, I mean, and I found a paper with these initials or a draft of it. And then I looked at the definition and I tried to unfold it semantically, just like I did here. And I think it's just that vibrations, and now I don't have space, are those maps that lift against and here we had interval-length conclusions, now we will use the diagonal. But we cannot talk about the diagonal generically, we have to use a different context, so to say. So we first apply a weakening, the opposite, the left adjoint weakening, right at sigma I. So here we take a certain push-up product, not in cubic sets, but rather in cubic sets over the interval. And then here we choose a co-fibration, or technically a co-fibration over the interval, which is just a map, which is the co-fibration of the underlying map. And here we then take the map from 1 to the interval in this context, in the size over I, which is now given by the diagonal. And that means that we copy the variable from the context and return it. So this is the, you can take these as generators for the new notion of vibration. Maybe just an analogy with this one here, I can give the same diagram for this one here. So suppose you have some object of co-fibrations over I, so that's a map A to B, which now lies over I, so let's say we have a map F from B to I, that's M as before, and now the push-up product that we take will be, in the bottom we have I times B, and here we have B plus A, I times A, and the map on the left is now given by F identity on V, and on the right is just I times M. So these are now the new generated co-fibrations.
Also a simple, I mean, before you said the maximal one is Copland minus the size of the monos, is there anything like this?
I didn't really talk about the co-fibrations here. This applied to the choice of co-fibrations, right? The things that we allow ourselves to put here. And you have the same kind of choice in the new model, but you have one more constraint, namely that the diagonal must be part of it. And in particular, you can still take the same maximal choice, those models which are component-wise decided. Oh, shit. We started at 4:15. Hot in here.
Maybe you should put your jacket off.
Yeah. across the sea.
Yeah. Okay. Okay. So now we introduced, without going into specifics, the various Kubica models that I'm aware of. Maybe there's yet another sprout of this magical cloud in development that I'm not aware of. I would hope so. And we can talk more specifically about model structures on Kubica sets. And there's a very elementary technique, actually not that specific to Kubica sets, that allows you from any setting, from any category with a model of homotopy type theory that at least contains like vibrant dependent products and a vibrant universe. And, some notion of co-vibration and vibration and some assumptions on those, such that every object is co-vibrant and so on. Such that when you have at least these two things and some more basic assumptions in the background, then you get a model structure on these cubical sets with the property that the vibrations are exactly the types. So what we, I call them vibrations already. So. So before I wanted to start this, I actually wanted to say, fix the Kubica model, which I just generically write as this. Could be either of these. So we get a model structure. On this with exactly those co-vibrations that we have chosen there and vibrations there. So that's just vibrations. And because it comes from these ingredients, just for the purpose of this talk, I will call it the type theoretic model structure to distinguish it from other model structures which we will consider. So theoretic model structure. And I use the superscript TT, and I don't use it as a subscript because I already have many subscripts to put for the box. However, this is not the only possible model structure you can consider. Someone already talked about 3D or generalized 3D model structures, so perhaps I should talk about test categories. So this is the first point. And the second is, Buchholz and Moorhaus, they did some examination of these various group categories, and they examined which of these were weak or strict test categories and so on. So basically all the group categories are test categories. And that's enough by some work that Szyszynski did in French, I guess, that there is a so-called test category model structure. On this, so test, where the weak equivalences, they are created from the following functor. First you go to categories by the category of elements functor, and then you take the nerve to simplicial sets with the Kahn model structure, and you see whether it's a weak equivalence in there. And the co-vibrations of the test category model structure are also just the monomorphisms. And if you use classical logic for comparison, for comparing these different things, and you always take the maximum choice of cofibrations, then at least the cofibrations of these two modern structures will be the same. Of course, unfortunately, we have a much less direct description of the weak equivalences in here, basically none. The cofibrations and the fibrations are the things which have direct descriptions in here. And finally, I should say that for those cube categories which admit at least a generalized Reedy structure, which will always turn out to be an elegant generalized Reedy structure, that you typically also have a third model structure, which people call the spatial model structure. Which has the same weak equivalences as the test category model structure, but different cofibrations. So this is what Szyszynski calls normal monomorphisms. And in particular implies that the only cofibrate objects are those which you can really build up from nothing by just adding cells that are not quotiented. So free cells. Cells that are free under the action of the automorphisms of the objects of the category with their symmetries. So I think this has been worked out concretely only for a few examples. So the first one, I guess, is symmetric simplicial sets, which you can also consider as a cube category, because you have all the structure from before. This is what Szyszynski did, and then some guy called Isaacson has considered the case this, but I mean, there are some. You can either choose both connections, or you can have one. I mean, maybe I'll just write one connection, and maybe there was something different I don't quite remember. So we also know that the test category model structure models omega groupoids. I forgot to say that when I wrote this down. So that's quite important. And of course also the spatial model structure, since it shares the weak equivalences with the test category model structure, also models omega groupoids. So if we were trying to show that our type theoretic construction of a model structure models omega groupoids, we could try to compare it to one of these. But that's not the only way in which we could try to establish the fact that this models omega groupoids. We could also just try to immediately realize our cubes as geometric objects and consider a geometric interpretation functor to topological spaces or simplicial sets given by triangulation. So that gives us basically two angles on trying or showing that the type theoretic models omega groupoids. The first one is, let's take the geometric realization. So that's just the cocontinuous extension of a functor that interprets any group as the geometric group, the geometric cube in topological spaces or simplicial sets. It is a Quillen equivalence or a left Quillen equivalence. And we get for free that it is a Quillen adjunction, a left Quillen functor, so it's only about whether it's really an equivalence. And the second approach is to try to compare the type theoretic model structure and the test category model structure. And apparently there's a huge body of theory on these test categories that is available to French mathematicians. And Ulrich has verified, for example, that all the weak equivalences in here will always be weak equivalences in here. So it's only about whether we really capture all the test category weak equivalences. Or phrased enough in other words, is the left Quillen functor from here to here a Quillen equivalence? These are the two angles. Questions while I raise the board, by the way. I hear your mumbling there, audience.
Your title contains a question, the title of your talk.
Yes.
Are you going to answer it? Is it a rhetorical question, or are you going to answer it?
No, I'm not going to answer it completely. But it's also not a rhetorical question. And in this section, I was going to now summarize everything that I know and hope for the audience to complete what is missing. But since it's only 15 minutes left, I'm not sure how far I will get, actually. I will just give a brief summary of all the facts that I know. I won't go into details for lack of time, but please feel free to ask me after the talk. So the first thing is that in cubical sets, let's say Cartesian and De Morgan, or anything that has reversals, doesn't really matter what else, as long as there's no fancy, I don't know, subdivision structure, anything that introduces a midpoint for reversals. One can make an observation, namely that the quotient Q defined by taking the interval and quotienting under the reversal operation gives you an object which geometrically should be contractible, because in topological spaces or in simplicial sets, if you take a line and you quotient it, well, topological spaces, you get a half line which is still contractible, but well, the pre-shift category here is not rich enough to recognize the midpoint of the interval. And you can use this object to actually prove that the type-theoretic model structure on this geometric realization function is not an equivalence for it. Mm-hmm. And Ulrich also has a nice argument that uses Quillen's theorem A for this category. I mean, you can compute the category elements of this and use Quillen's theorem A to essentially see what homotopy type its nerve has, and from that you can also conclude that geometric realization is not a Quillen equivalence. So the key facts here is that because of our choice of cofibrations, this is a cofibrin object. In all these models, all objects are cofibrin, and that's kind of what's not so good when you look at these quotients. So I would say it's kind of ill-behaved. It's contractible under geometric realization, but you can show by an elementary argument that actually, if you have such a symmetric line and a fibrant type, a fibrant cubical set, that it will never be possible to relate this to something that is constant by a homotopy. If you just have any line in a fibrant cubical set, of course it will be homotopic to something constant. You can construct this, but you cannot do it in a way that is stable under reversal. because the homotopy itself that relates it to something constant must also be stable under reversal.
So can you summarize the argument from the beginning to the end, rather than from the end to the beginning?
Say again?
Can you summarize the argument? What is your claim and what is the proof?
So the ultimate claim is that the geometric realization from this and whatever stuff you want to add to simplicial sets or topological spaces, doesn't really matter, is not equivalence. Yeah.
So this is a negative answer to the question in your title.
Well, for
one
question,
special case,
yes.
For this special case.
Yes, so it says that reversals are bad because we don't have a representative for the midpoint, which is the fixed point under reversing.
Mm-hmm. They said no matter what you add, but if you add something which gives
yes.
you that.
Yes, yeah. I mean, I said this before, you're just copying what I said.
Sure. I thought both of you said.
You could have connections that won't change this. Right?
That won't change this. No. I mean, this applies to the De Morgan model that was the first instantiation of the CCHM model. But reversals were never really necessary, so far this doesn't really tell us anything bad. I mean, who cares about reversals, right? But the thing is that you can replay this argument for a different quotient, one dimension higher, so you can take the square and you can quotient it under swapping if you have symmetries. And then you can see if you have a diagonal in there or not. And if you don't have a diagonal, then, well, the same kind of behavior happens. You don't have a fixed point for the action. And you can actually also use this to show that the geometric realization function is not equivalence for the test category model structure either. So a replay for this in, and now it's crucial that we don't have a midpoint for the swapping. So we can only do this argument for symmetric one-order cubic sets, not for Cartesian ones. And last but not least, of course, this only talks about one possible way of comparing the time-fitting model structure with spaces, but you can actually adapt this argument to show that the law of extruded middle fails in these cubical sets. So for example, in Cartesian with reversal or symmetries and so on. And you can go further and examine the statement of extruded middle and see that it's an invariant property of the presented higher category. It doesn't depend on the particular presentation. So of course it's preserved on equivalences of higher categories. So there could not be any equivalence of the presented higher categories of, for example, cubical sets with symmetries and omega groupoids. It's LEM can really be seen as a property, an intrinsic property of the underlying quasi-category, if you wish. You can define what it means for LEM to hold for a quasi-category. Okay? And using the model structure that we have, it's quite easy to relate the statement of LEM for the model structure to the statement of LEM for the presented infinity one category. So that gives you that there cannot be any equivalence to omega groupoids. So for these models in particular, we now have a final answer to the question that was asked at the beginning of the talk. But these are not all the models, and in particular the...
So which models are there? Are the models?
Any model that has reversals but no representative for the midpoint of the reversal operation, and any model that has a symmetry but not a diagonal.
The BCH model.
The BCH model, for example, the first one. Okay, next in line would be this CCHM model without reversals, but let's first talk about the most recent thing, the Cartesian cubes without connections. And just last week we found out, if everything is correct, I guess, there are always mistakes lurking everywhere, of course, that that the argument can also be adapted to a Cartesian cubical sets with nothing else. So this applies to the claim that geometric realization is not equivalence, as well as the claim that Lorentz group fails to hold in that model. And I mean, one last thing that I should definitely make here is that Lorentz group refers to homotopical propositions, not strict propositions in the sense of just the pre-sheet category at the top.
So this is lem for
H-prop. Yes. Okay. I mean, for strict props it holds, but for, it's about homotopical propositions. So both this geometricalization claim and the Lorentz-Dudel middle claim fails to hold, it seems, if everything is correct. So, negative result. Like this. What remains is basically the CCHM model without reversals. So Cartesian and connections. And the reason why these arguments cannot be replayed in there is that there's actually already an elementary homotopy equivalence of this object Q already with a turbular cubic set before even mapping it into something vibrant or not. Please sit down. Do not stand up. So there we actually have we have a homotopy equivalence like this. And you could, that's really my final remark now, you could think what is special about this model. And one thing that is special about this category, the underlying index category, is that it's a full subcategory of posets, just like the simplex category. So an alternative definition that was observed in a paper by Kapulkin and Polvatsky is that this is equivalently the full subcategory of posets on objects of the form 1 to the n, like before, just like the simplex category. And maybe that is a reason for why this has still chances. I don't really know. I exhausted all my ideas for this. And as I said before, this is not even an elegant or generalized greedy category. So all these greedy techniques do not apply. If you have any ideas for deciding this question for this particular model, please tell me. Thank you.
I think these are nice results concerning a constructive semantical consistency field. So what do we know? Are there new results concerning formal consistency proof?
Formal consistency proofs?
Yeah.
I don't quite see the connection to consistent.
Not depending on the semantical constructions here. I remember in the end of the introductional book on homotopy theory, there was a formal proof in the end, but without the Bobovsky univalent axiom.
Okay, so first, what exactly do you mean by consistency? Do you just mean consistency of the logical theory?
In the sense of a formal theoretical theory.
I mean, I don't see how these results. I don't see how these results tell you anything about that.
This is a known, a consequence of the model that is consistent.
I mean, classically we know that sufficient set model is consistent, and constructively we also know it for the cubical models. But consistency is not enough to tell you that the models are the same. The underlying high categories are the same. In theory, it could still be the case that they prove different things.
I wonder, why would you actually expect this? I mean, it seems that you have lots of negative results. So maybe you should revisit what actually, I mean, this was your first, what you got in the beginning, but why would we expect that?
Yeah, to be honest, we don't really expect it, I think. Yeah. I mean, some people have said they expect it, but I don't buy this.
This cubic middle is not validated in the cubical model?
Yeah. in most of the cubical models.
Which for which theory? OTT plus what?
Second, UTT.
For OTT plus?
Everything that you can have in cubital theory, high inductive types, univariant universes.
So it's really not classical.
Yeah, but we already knew this due to sheaf model constructions, right?
That LEM was independent, yes.
Yeah.
Yeah. But this is about one particular model. It doesn't say anything about the theory.
Could one summarize these results and that all cubical set models, apart from one for which it is unknown,
yeah,
are non-standard models in the sense of homotopy theory?
Yeah, you could. Yeah.
Okay. So I think we should stop here for the questions and let us have a 5 minutes break and thank the speaker again.